Okay, so once again, good morning, everybody. The screen is not updating. So last time what we talked about was, we were talking about just the Hamiltonian for a free particle, right? In a potential well. So are there any questions about this before I go on? Okay, so we had seen that you have the time-independent Schrodinger equation, right, which you can get by factoring out the time-dependent part of the wave function. And then I had talked about a particle in a box and how one can create this situation in an experimental setting. So what you have to do is, you have to, so this is a one-dimensional box. You have to create a situation where there is a potential difference between this region and the regions outside you know, whatever interval you want. So one way to do that, for example, is that if you take a straight line, well, a wire, and you connect a battery, or, you know, basically you create a negative volt potential at both ends. So here there's a negative potential, and here this is the negative potential of some battery, right? Or some external voltage source. So if you have an electron, for instance, right, this electron will be repelled from this side and from this side, right? So it will feel as if there is a boundary. So the stronger you make the potential, right? So this is U naught, and in the laboratory you can control U naught with a slider, with some dial. Okay, so then the finite potential well, what do we have? We have, there are three regions, regions 1, 2, and 3. Am I audible? Can somebody please confirm? Because yes, I can't, sir, see anybody's, yes, faces, so I have no,
yes, sir,
no visual reaction. So so what we have is the potential, right? So and now this is a choice of definition, by the way, to put U0 here and plus U0 here, right? But the only thing that really matters is the difference in the potential, delta U. But making this choice will makes our calculations a little bit easier. That's what we need. Okay. Now, so we have these three regions, and we have to solve the Schrodinger equation in all three regions. And what we find is that the solution is very simple, right? It's just a superposition of plane waves in all three regions. But the difference is that there's a difference in the momentum, K. So in region two, in the center of, inside the box, momentum is given by this expression. And in the regions outside the box, it is given by this expression. So you just have to subtract the potential from the total energy. Right, and that makes sense, because for the particle to go to that region outside the box, it has to do work, right? So it has to lose this much energy, right? So so its momentum will also decrease. So now you have again, the same thing. You have a superposition of eigenstates. And so now let me write down once again. Let me take. Okay. Okay, now I will switch to using the symbol psi for the wave function. I was using the symbol f, but now I'll switch to using psi. So we'll have three solutions of psi, psi1x, psi2x, and psi3x. Right? Psi1x is some superposition, let's call it a1 e to the I k prime x b1 e to the minus k prime x. Psi3 is also a superposition, but now the thing is you have to be careful because the coefficients need not be the same, right? So you have to, because you know what the eigenstates are, these are the eigenstates, right? But the actual solution is going to be some linear combination of those eigenstates. And that linear combination can depend on a number of things. We'll see what it depends on in 1 second. And in region two, we'll write it like this, e to the ikx, e to the minus ikx. Okay, and these coefficients are unknown at the moment. And here we have that k prime is equal to square root of 2m e minus u naught by h bar squared. And here we have k is equal to root of 2m e naught h bar squared. Okay. All right. So now first let's take the case of infinite potential. So infinite potential is the case when u naught goes to infinity, right? So if you look at this expression for k prime is equal to h bar squared. So if u naught goes to infinity, then e minus u naught, right, this quantity inside the square root, is always less than zero for any positive e, right? It doesn't matter what the energy is. The energy itself is not infinite, right? The energy is the energy of the particle, so it's some finite number. So if u naught goes to infinity, then this quantity is always less than zero level. Technically, I should say less than or equal to zero. So if this quantity is negative and there's a square root over here, right? So what will happen? What will you get? You will get I, right? You will get root of minus one and then 2m over h bar squared. Absolute value of e minus u naught, right? This is what your k prime is going to be. Is this clear? I hope this is clear to everybody, okay? If it's not, please ask. Okay, so now, and this I will write, right? So this quantity is a, and this can be plus or minus, so we'll put a plus minus. Because when you take the square root, you can get there. And this I will write as, I'll just write it as magnitude of k prime, because that's what it is, right? K prime is equal to I times the magnitude. Okay, so now let's look at these solutions once again. Okay, so this is our solution. Now let's look at what happens to the first term. E to the I k prime x, right? So now we substitute this expression in here, right? And for definiteness, I will just take the positive sign of the square root. If you take the positive sign, what do you get? You get E you have one factor of I, one factor of I, you get a minus sign. You get minus, right? I squared is minus K prime X. Similarly, what happens to the second term? In the second term, you get E prime, and then now you get a plus sign, right? Because I squared is minus one, but you have a negative sign here. Okay, so this is what happens in region one. Now let us make a plot of these solutions. Okay, so let's see what these solutions look like. Psi x, and we are talking about region one. So region one is here, right? This is a potential. This is region two, and this is region three. Now, what does this expression look like? This expression is a negative, it's a decreasing potential, right? It's a decreasing exponential, right? So it looks something like this. And it will cross the origin here at some value of this thing at one, right? Because that's where epsilon of exponent of zero is one. What about the other one, the other branch of the solution? Looks like this. Okay. So this is E K prime X, and this is E to the minus K prime X over here. Now remember that these two solutions are only valid in region one. Even though I've drawn them in extending into region two and three, they're only valid in region one, right? So I'll just make this line dashed to indicate the fact that we don't really care about this portion. Okay. Now, if you look at these two branches, you will have to throw out one of the branches. Why is that? Can anybody tell me?
E power minus mod k prime x needs to be thrown out because it's not normalizable. Even if we square it, the square of that function would basically not have a finite area under it. So
right. So we want, right, remember that we want to have our wave function must have satisfy this property. Right, what is this? This is called normalization. When you do it, it's normalization, and if a function possesses this property, it's called normalizability. What it means is basically that psi square is a probability density. Right? And probability, when you add up all the probabilities, you should get one. Now you can see that this integration is over the full. Okay, got disconnected there, sorry about that. So this integration is over the full domain of our system. And so this integration can be broken up into three parts, right? From minus infinity to zero, where it will be psi 1x squared plus integration from 0 to L, where it will be psi 2x squared. And then a third part from x is equal to L to plus infinity, where it will be psi 3x And this is becoming very crowded. Squared. Okay. So psi 1 x squared, all three terms individually, they should be less than, they should be finite, right? So we can't keep this term, right? Because this will have an infinite area, right? When you integrate this from minus infinity to zero, you will get an infinite number. All right. So for u naught, when u naught goes to infinity, what do we find? We find that we have to throw this branch away, and this branch means we have to set a1 to zero, right? So if u naught goes to infinity, then a1 has to go to zero, right? So that this solution does not contribute at all. Okay. Now, what about this is if u naught goes to infinity, or actually if u naught is greater than e, more, that would be the more correct statement. If u naught is greater than the energy, then a1 has to be set to zero. So the same way, right, the exact same way, we can look at region 3. Okay. Okay, now in region 3, what will happen is you have the exact same set of solutions, but the only thing is, so I can just shift this over here. Well, it will be something. Actually, let me just draw it again. Okay, so now again, you will get two branches in region 3 in exactly the same way. So if you look at psi 3x, what do you have? You have, right, we wrote down this expression. Now in region 3, once again, what will happen? This will be the same, right? This will, you'll get exactly the same behavior for both of these functions, right? But now, which branch needs to be thrown away? The branch which needs to be thrown away, so there will be one branch, and I'll draw it like this. This is one branch. This corresponds to e to the plus k prime x. And then there'll be a second branch, which looks like okay, that's not good. Right, and so this branch looks like e to the minus k prime x. right? And I have to throw this branch out, right? So this tells me that again, in region 3, if U naught is greater than E, this implies that B2 should be equal to 0. Okay, so what do we have? If we have psi 1x is equal to A1 e to the plus k prime x, and psi 3x is equal to B2 times e to the minus k. Right, because in the first case, you have to set, which one do you have to set? One second. B1 is there. This should be B1. And decreasing one, A2. So this, yeah, B2 is zero. So that means this will be A2. These are the two solutions in those two regions. What about region 2? In region 2, we have c to the ikx, d to the e minus ikx. Okay? And here, it doesn't matter what the value of E is, because the potential is zero, right? So that means that we still have to consider, we have to keep both of these coefficients C and D. By the way, if anybody is not following for any reason, you have any question, please ask me, okay? I hope that you are all familiar with solving differential equations and so on. If you are not, consider this a course in, first course in linear differential equations, okay? So now, how can we determine these coefficients, right? These coefficients are not known. We have to determine them in order to get a complete solution of the problem. Okay? So now, and here, by the way, these are the solutions for finite U. Okay? Am I audible? I'm just getting really tired of this Zoom. It's turning out to be as useless as Google Meet. Okay, so this is true for finite U naught. Okay. What happens? So when U naught goes to infinity, things become a little bit more simple, right? So when U naught goes to infinity, what happens to these solutions in the first and second regions? Psi 1x and psi 3x, they both go to zero. Okay? And it's easy to see why. For psi 3x, remember that x is positive, right? X is greater than L. For psi 1x, x is less than zero. So this whole exponent is negative, right? So when U naught goes to infinity, what happens to K prime, absolute value of K prime? That also goes to infinity. And since this becomes exponent of negative of an infinite quantity, Sachin, please mute yourself unless you have a question.
Sorry, sir.
So, right, the exponent of a negative quantity is zero. So this goes to zero, okay? So we are left only with psi 2x. Great, wonderful. So now what we have figured out is that for our infinite potential, right? So I should make these walls of the box infinitely high, right? But obviously, this is just a representation. So I get psi 1x is equal to zero. psi 2 x is equal to, sorry, psi 3 x is equal to 0 and psi 2 x here. Now we can determine what psi 2 is going to be, right? We can determine what c and d are going to be. How do we determine those? So now remember that our wave function is the solution of a differential equation, right? Which looks like this, right? Now this kind of an equation, this is called a second order linear ordinary differential equation, right? Ordinary because, well, I mean, even though I'm writing this as a partial derivative, there is only a derivative with respect to x here, right? There are no other variables. So it's linear because this is a linear, all of the terms are linear in x. There is nothing like psi of x squared. There is no d by dx squared. Okay, so you don't have a term like this, d psi by dx squared. You don't have a term like this, right? You have a second derivative, but a second derivative is also a linear operator. So such a, equation, the solutions have to satisfy certain requirements. They have to satisfy certain requirements. What are those requirements? The first thing is that psi of x and psi prime x, what is psi prime x? It's just the derivative. So now I'll just write it as d psi by dx, okay? Both of these have to be continuous everywhere. Why do they need to be continuous? So imagine that you have a function f of x, okay, and let's take a function which has a discontinuity somewhere here, let's say. Okay, so this function has a discontinuity, right? If it has a discontinuity, then can you define the derivative at the point of discontinuity? I should continue this function up here. Can you define the derivative of f at this point? Let's say x naught. What is f prime at x naught?
It's a delta function.
No, it's not defined. I mean, okay. Who was that? I missed it. Was that Priya?
Yes, sir.
Okay. No, so thanks. That's a clever observation. You could define it to be the delta function, but the point is that the delta function is not there. It's not a function, right? It's a distribution. It's not a well-defined function. That means there is no unique functional expression which gives you delta, right? Delta is only defined as a distribution. Delta function is defined by its property, this property that this is equal to f naught. Now, this, whatever you want to put here for delta, it can take many values. There are many different kinds of functions which can give you this result. So it's not a uniquely defined quantity, right? So as a function, this f prime x is not defined at that point, right? Because f prime x here, when you approach from the left and when you approach from the right, you will get different values, right? Okay, well, not in this case, but we can consider another function which looks like this, let's say. Something like this. So now here, f prime x on one side has a positive value, and on the other side, it has a negative value. Similarly, if psi of x is discontinuous, then what can we say about, well, f prime of x is not defined. And so this means that f double prime x is also not defined. Right? So this is if psi of x, so we are talking about psi. So again, switching between psi and phi, I shouldn't do that. So if this is not continuous, okay, similarly, this is not defined. What if, what you can have a situation where psi x is continuous, right? But psi prime x is not continuous. As an example, you can consider a function of this form, right? So if you look at this function, you can see that the function is continuous in x, but the derivative of the function is not going to be continuous. The derivative of the function here, if you plot the derivative, you will get some positive value over here, and in here you will get some negative value. So, and since psi prime is not continuous, that means this is not defined, right? So the point is that this equation ceases to be well defined at those points where either psi or psi prime is not continuous and where psi prime is not differentiable. Okay, so here in this example I gave you for this function, psi is not differentiable at this point. Right? When I say psi is not differentiable, what that means is that psi prime is not continuous. Because when you differentiate psi, you get a function with a discontinuity. Okay, so what do we find? We find that psi has to be continuous and psi prime has to be continuous. Both of these conditions have to be true. So if you look at this situation, this box, what we can say is that as you come to zero from the from the left-hand side, the value of psi 1x should equal, as you come to zero from the left-hand side, of psi 2x. What this basically means is that, so this is your potential well. You have some psi 1 over here, and this is psi 1. This is psi 2, right? And this is psi 3. So the function psi, which is a combination of all of these, has to be continuous, right? That means that when you come to this point, x is equal to 0, or when you come to x is equal to L, either from the left or from the right, the values of these functions should match up. Right, the functions themselves are not the same. Their limit as you go to the boundary, should be the same. Right, so this is known as a boundary condition. okay? Then you get one more boundary condition for the second point. As x goes to L from the minus side, psi 2x should be equal to limit x goes to L from the positive side of psi 3x. Okay, so these two boundary conditions must be satisfied. Now, for u goes to infinity, what did we see? We saw that psi 1x and psi 3x, they both go to zero, right? So this tells us right away that psi 2x should also go to zero, where at x is equal to zero and at x is equal to L, right? Otherwise it will not match the values of these functions. So we have now, we have these two conditions, that psi 2x is equal to zero at x is equal to zero and x is equal to L. And we have the expression for psi 2 also. What is psi 2? It was this object, right? So now let me put in this condition that psi 2 x is equal to zero is equal to zero, right? So now if you put this in here, what do you get? You get C plus D is equal to zero. If you put the condition for X is equal to L, you will get C times E to the IKL plus D times E to the minus IKL is equal to zero, right? The first one tells you that C is equal to minus D. So you can substitute that expression in here in the second constraint. So these are constraints, by the way. These are called constraints. Constraints are conditions that have to be satisfied by your coefficients. So if you put this, the first solution of the first constraint in the second constraint, you get C e to the IKL minus C e to the minus IKL is equal to zero, right? You can cancel the C out because it's common. E to the IKL minus E to the minus IKL, what does that become? That becomes equal to 2 times C sine K, right? And the C drops out. So we are left with the requirement that sine of KL sine of KL has to be equal to zero. What does this tell us about KL? KL has to be equal to n pi, where n is equal to some integer, positive integer, right? Because sine n pi is equal to zero. So immediately what we know from this is that the momentum K, right? And now I'll put a label KN over here, is equal to N pi by L. Which tells us that the momentum is quantized, right? Because it takes on certain discrete values, right? Not a continuous set, not values in a continuous set. And when we looked at the solution of the free particle, for instance, right? So for a free particle, there is no constraint on the momentum. right? For a free particle where u naught is equal to zero everywhere, there is no constraint on the momentum. So the momentum can take any value, positive or negative, right? But here, what we find is that the momentum can only take, and this I should say is that n is equal to, it can be a negative integer also. So this this basically means that the set Z, which is a set of all integers, except for the number zero, right? So this is minus infinity to minus three to minus one, plus two, plus, and so on. Okay? So your momentum is quantized. And what is the energy? Remember that the momentum was related to the energy by this expression, 2m e by h bar squared, right? So now I'll put an n on both the momentum and the energy is equal to n pi l. This tells me that en is equal to n squared pi squared h bar squared over 2m l squared. All right, so this completes our solution of the one-dimensional Schrodinger equation in an infinite potential well. We have the explicit form of the wave function. What is the wave function look like now? It's equal to C e to the I K X D e to the minus I K X, but D and C are related. So I can write this as C times e to the ikx minus e to the minus ikx. So this becomes 2c sine kx. But the momentum k is quantized, right? So this becomes 2c sine, what are the allowed values of the momentum? N pi by L times x. So I'll just put psi of nx. This is your state, psi of nx, and this is for x is less than equal to L and greater than or equal to zero. Outside this region, psi is zero, right? Now we have not determined what C is, but we can determine C by taking psi x squared dx to be one. When you do this, you will get that C is equal, you will get that 2C is equal to root 2 by, right? And this is an exercise which I'll leave for you. It's an easy exercise, but it's important to do it. If you cannot do it, you should let me know, okay? All right, so I'll stop here. Any questions? No questions? Okay. Stop the recording.